Headline Audio presents Pathfinders by Cecil Lewis, read by John Telfer. About the author. Cecil Lewis, 1898-1997. Cecil Lewis, 1898-1997, was a British fighter ace in the First World War and spent time as a flying instructor for the RAF, the Royal Air Force, during the Second World War, as well as in active service in that conflict. One of the founding executives of the BBC, he enjoyed friendships with many of the creative figures of the day, including George Bernard Shaw, winning an Academy Award for the 1938 film adaptation of Shaw's Pygmalion. Lewis was a prolific writer, and his autobiographical account, Sagittarius Rising, became a classic of First World War literature, considered by many as the definitive work on aerial combat. He retained a passion for adventure throughout his life and was the last surviving British fighter ace of the First World War. Introduction. One of the legacies of the First World War was the proliferation of war novels that were published in the late 1920s and 1930s. Erich Maria Remarque's All Quiet on the Western Front was a bestseller and made into a Hollywood film in 1930. In the same year, Siegfried Sassoon's Memoirs of an Infantry Officer sold 24,000 copies. Generations of schoolchildren have grown up on a diet of the novels and memoirs published during the interwar period. Indeed, the author of this novel, Cecil Lewis, wrote a best-selling memoir of his time as a pilot in the Royal Flying Corps, which became the Royal Air Force in April 1918, entitled Sagittarius Rising, 1936. George Bernard Shaw described it as a book which everybody should read. It is the autobiography of an ace, and no common ace either. This prince of pilots has had a charmed life in every sense of the word. He is a thinker, a master of words, and a bit of a poet. These attributes Lewis also brings to his little-known novel about the Second World War in the skies, Pathfinders. Cecil Lewis enjoyed an exciting and varied career, ranging from First World War pilot and fighter ace to teaching pilots in China during the 1920s, to becoming one of the founding directors of the fledgling BBC. He won a fourth share of an Oscar for the screen adaptation of George Bernard Shaw's Pygmalion in 1938. Contrasting the two world wars, Lewis sagely commented in one of his autobiographical volumes, "In 1914, everybody wanted to fight. In 1939, nobody wanted to. It was a very different situation." He continued, "I remember feeling sick in the stomach at the prospect of fighting another war, and particularly one where the odds seemed loaded against us to the point where we could not possibly win." He rejoined the Royal Air Force Reserve and was initially a controller on Thorny Island, but was moved to the Air Ministry to join the publicity staff, where he remained during the Battle of Britain. Lewis was later involved in ways of detecting enemy bombing attacks. He then, however, took a demotion from wing commander to flying officer in order to fly again, becoming a flight lieutenant, having undertaken the elementary training instructor's course. He taught hundreds of pilots to fly at an elementary flying training school, including his own son. In All My Yesterdays, his 1993 autobiography, he wrote, "Pupils were graded by the time it took them to go solo. Any who managed this with 9 hours instruction were destined for fighters, 9 to 12 went to bombers, 12 to 14 to transport aircraft. Those who could not make it by 14 hours would have to be content with other jobs in aircrew." It was whilst training these potential pilots that Lewis wrote Pathfinders, set in 1942 and originally published in 1944. The situation in early 1942 was extremely serious. The Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor and across Southeast Asia had turned the conflict into a world war. In the West, the situation was no better, which is made very clear early on in the novel. It was the spring of 1942. The news was bad. The Russians were falling back under the hammer blows of the Hun. The Ukraine was gone. The Donets Basin was going. There was a threat to the Caucasus, to the Volga, to Stalingrad. No man could see the end. And though the Russians were putting up magnificent and heroic rearguard actions, they were being slowly and inexorably forced back. In Egypt, things were no better. Rommel was striking at the gates of Cairo. The British were in retreat. Tobruk had fallen. British Empire and Commonwealth armed forces were at a nadir, but with the promise of future Allied operations in the wider context of the war. The RAF's Bomber Command was the only branch of the armed forces that could take direct action against Germany. There was nothing left to do but bomb. In spite of the calls made on her for aircraft to be sent to all parts of the world, the home bomber force was growing. It could and must be used in an all-out offensive on German industry. In no other way could England carry the war to the enemy. True, the darkest days when she stood alone against the powers of anarchy were over. The waves, the Prime Minister had said that year, may be against us, but the tide is for us. But the tide was still at ebb, and the transformation that was to take place before the end of the year had not begun. The strategic air offensive against Germany changed from precision to area bombing before Air Chief Marshal Arthur Harris, nicknamed Bomber Harris, took over Bomber Command in February 1942, largely as precision bombing had proved inaccurate. With area bombing, whole cities were targeted in order to destroy factories as well as the morale of those who worked in them. One of the first 1,000 bomber raids was on Cologne in May 1942. The city was bombed for nearly 2 hours, destroying 3,300 houses, killing 486 people, and making 59,100 people temporarily homeless. The bomber aircrews were well aware of the military necessity of what they were undertaking. The killing of civilians was not their primary objective, but rather the military-industrial targets in order to help end the war. Destroying cities began unintentionally, but became the eventual object of the bombing campaign. The success of Bomber Command has been contentious ever since, with Bomber Harris remaining a controversial figure. Even at the time, the author and novelist Vera Brittain, who had been a nurse near the front during the First World War, was an active campaigner for the abolition of area bombing. As a result, there were calls for her internment, and she was often ostracized by a British society that predominantly supported the raids. Unsurprisingly, Pathfinders stays away from moral judgment of area bombing itself, focusing more on the sacrifice made by the Allied airmen it depicts. The novel also makes some interesting comments on the Prime Minister and his wartime coalition government, which, under the guise of fiction, could garner greater clarity to the wartime situation. For instance, when Thornley's father-in-law comments that Churchill's saved the country, Thornley replies, "Yes, he has, and we're supporting his dictatorship today in a way that would have seemed intolerable in, say, 1938. We're as much regimented and taxed as the enemy. More, in fact." The story centers around the crew of a Wellington bomber that acted as a pathfinder. Pathfinders were needed because often the bombers could not find the towns and cities they were designated to attack at night, let alone the industrial centers within them. The Pathfinder Force was established on the 11th of August 1942 under the command of Air Commodore Donald Bennett, but bomber crews were carrying out a Pathfinder role earlier in 1942, as in this novel, by using colored marker flares to guide the bombers to their targets. Bennett later wrote, "Cecil Lewis's novel reminds us of the hopes and fears and the sacrifices and of our ultimate success." The crews selected were the best nighttime flying crews, who were able to find the target unaided. The crew in the novel comprises of six men: the pilot, Hugh Thornley, who is also the squadron commander, co-pilot Peter Morelli, the navigator Tom Cookson, wireless operator Benji Lukin, and the front and rear gunners Sam Dollar and Nobby Bly, respectively. Thornley believes, with a crew like his, a man could do anything. They were absolutely first class. He couldn't do enough for them. They reciprocated by giving him their best all the time, in every emergency, and when there was no emergency. The real heart of the novel lies in the backstories of all these men who originate from Britain, the USA, Canada, and New Zealand. Indeed, by 1945, some 45% of Bomber Command pilots were Canadians, Australians, or New Zealanders. Many trained as pilots or aircrew through the British Empire Air Training Scheme at specially opened air bases in Australia, Canada, New Zealand, South Africa, and Southern Rhodesia. Peter Morelli's training is described as part of his story, no doubt drawing on Lewis's own time as an instructor. Pilots were scarce then, and all were welcome. It took a year to get through it all. He had thought he could fly before. The standard was very high. Night bomber crews were the most technically proficient men of any air force in the world. After his time as an instructor, Lewis was in command of an air transport post at Catania in Sicily. From there, he went to Bahia and then on to Athens, where his unit became embroiled in the Greek Civil War. After the war, he set up a failed farming community in South Africa, was a radio producer for the United Nations, and then worked for the Daily Mail, principally as the organizer of the Ideal Home exhibition. In 1969, he sailed a boat to Corfu, where he spent the remainder of his life. He died in 1997, 2 months short of his 99th birthday. This wide-ranging novel with backstories from across the globe is heavily influenced by the author's wide variety of interests and jobs. The success of the work lies not so much in the combat scenes, but in sketching out the inner life of each member of the crew. There were hundreds of those worlds aloft, each with its complement of men, each dedicated to a single task, each trained and disciplined, each nothing but a name and number while the job was on, yet each one a life. A life. Precious to some or one for little things, the way the hair grew, or a tone of voice, or tender hands, or body's strength. Precious because of memories, mothers of travail and the long hard years bringing them up to this, wives of their husbands, clasped and torn apart, dearer than life and gone. Lovers of promises, the future in a kiss, the hope, the dream stretched out to. Brothers and friends, of sport and work and the old coat of friendship. Precious and separate, more than the jobs they gave their skill to, more than the messengers of death, more than their country's sons, more than all that. These men with dreams and hopes and plans of things to come, each with his past, the sheaf of personality, the soul. Casualty rates for Bomber Command were the highest across the armed forces. An estimated 135,000 men flew in combat in Bomber Command, of whom 47,268 died in action. Lewis's evocative novel depicting the lives and fates of just six of these men is here reprinted for a new generation of readers, showing the significance of the individual life stories of a Second World War aircrew. Alan Jeffries, 2021. Chapter 1. Out of my weakness to her strength, out of my fear to her courage, out of my doubt to her faith.
"We're foul or something."
It was Sam, down in the engine room, who noticed it first. He shouted up through the hatchway to the skipper. The wheezy little engine had started to grunt and labour, straining and complaining at the sudden heavy load. The steam sizzled and whistled through the leaky pipe joints, while the whole squalid, smelly engine room with its pools of oil and coal dust began a crazy rolling that swung the hurricane lantern back and forth on its nail as if it had gone mad, sent a shovel slithering across the floor, and set the coal rattling against the sides of the bunkers.
"Another goddamn wreck," thought Sam. "Who'd be a fisherman in wartime? Mines and Heinkels, and no light, and worst of all, no goddamn fish."
This was their fourth trawl today, and they hadn't boxed the price of a pint. He wiped his hands on a lump of waste and poked his head up through the hatch. The skipper was leaning out of the wheelhouse window, his eyes fixed on a pool of yellowish foam under the counter. They were foul of something, all right. The Daffodil had no way on her, and the propeller was simply churning up the sandy waters of the shallow sea. In the short, steep swell that was tossing the trawler about like a bit of old cork, the warp kept snubbing and jerking as it flicked up out of the troughs, flinging the spray from it, vibrating like a banjo string, and then sinking back as the stern dropped. The towing post creaked and grunted. They were foul of something, all right.
"Take up the bridle a turn or two, John,"
the skipper shouted to a deckhand who was gutting fish and packing it amidships. The man nodded, stuck his knife in his belt, and lurched forward along the plunging deck. When he reached the capstan, where the bridle of the trawl was made fast, he opened the steam valve, unrove the tail of the bridle from its cleat, and seized it firmly in his hands. The steam wheezed into the cylinder, and the drum, complaining and rattling, started to turn. He hauled on the tail of the rope till he heard the skipper's voice,
"That'll do, John."
Then he closed the valve, made fast the bridle, and came aft. Shortening up the bridle canted the trawler's head to port. She began to bear off in a wide circle, tethered like a nanny goat to the trawl, which was, in turn, anchored firmly to the seabed. She made heavy weather of it, wallowed, and shook herself as the beam seas came crashing against her rusty sides. But slowly, persistently, and reluctantly, round she went. The skipper was watching that length of dripping rope astern. It swung outwards in a long crescent behind the Daffodil. He was hoping to see the crescent straighten up. Pulling in a circle round the obstruction should free the beam from whatever was foul of it. Then he would be able to continue on his way. But no, there it stayed, that maddening crescent, till the Daffodil had plunged and lurched her way round a full circle and was heading back on her first course. The watch below were fast asleep. The lurching and rolling of the ship didn't disturb their slumber, but when the motion changed, then they knew, even in their sleep, that something was wrong. One by one they woke, tumbled out, yawning and swearing, pulled on their oilskins and came on deck. Now there were seven men besides the skipper, anxiously watching that straining warp. Anxiously because the whole gear was new, and it was new because a week ago they had fouled something, and when at last they had got the trawl in, there, bobbing and swaying under the water, right against the ship's side, was the huge, rusty globe of a mine. It was big enough to blow up a battleship and firmly entangled in the trawl. When they saw it, leaning over the side, straining on the meshes of the net, they didn't like what they saw. They didn't like it at all. They were fishermen, not minesweepers, and this catch was no good on their market. There was only one thing to do, and they did it quite quickly, though reluctantly and angrily, namely to slash the fastenings of the net clear of the beam and let it all go, mine, fish, net, and all, back to the muddy bottom. Now they were foul of something again.
"Another bloody mine, I bet,"
said Fred Whiting, the mate.
"Might be a couple of mermaids,"
suggested little Percy Condon, the humorist of the crew.
"Might be a couple of mermaids waiting to kiss the end of your ruddy nose, young Fred."
"Mermaids, my
growled Fred. He was cold and hadn't had enough sleep, and the thought of another mine didn't fascinate him. He remembered a couple of months back how they had been fishing when, suddenly, off to starboard, they had heard an explosion. When they got over to the place, the trawler that had been there was nothing but wreckage and floating fish and a cloud of seagulls. The sea was fuller of mines than fish these days. 10 to 1, there was another bobbing in the poke of the trawl right now, pretty well underneath them. The skipper, seeing the trawl hadn't cleared, shouted down to the engineer,
"I'm gonna run back over her, Sam. Give me all you can."
He swung the wheel to port, and the Daffodil turned on her heel and went about, bucking into the tide, squirming her way through the quarter sea. The bridle of the trawl went straight down under the counter. There was some danger of it fouling the propeller, but the skipper knew his business. One hand on the wheel, leaning out of the window, he watched the lie of the rope, watched the bite of it looping out on the quarter, keeping the Daffodil clear. When they had gone about, he spun the wheel central, and the trawler, gathering way now that she had no load, forged ahead. There were 90 fathoms of warp between the ship and her trawl, so she had quite a good run. The skipper hoped her speed would jerk the beam clear. He watched the warp anxiously as it streamed out astern. Suddenly, it tightened, flicked up clear of the sea. The strain, coming hard on the mooring post and the capstan, started both of them grunting and straining as if they would be yanked out of the ship. The warp itself stretched fibre against fibre. The water ran from it, and the Daffodil, brought up all standing, squatted by the stern and bucked and plunged, while the old two-cylinder engine, forced to work against a sudden overwhelming load, snorted itself to a standstill. Another pool of yellowish, frothy foam appeared under the counter.
"Bloody well anchored we are, and that's a fact," commented young Percy.
But the others took no notice. They knew what this meant. It meant another wasted trawl, a short haul of fish, less money for the wife, and a good chance of being blown into kingdom come. They looked at the sky. It was well on into the afternoon. The wind was freshening. They had to get back to port before nightfall. There was no time to lose. Some of them went below to get their aprons. Others went forward, ready to cast off the bridle from the capstan. Daffodil wallowed in the trough of the sea.
"We'll have to get her in,"
the skipper called to Sam and left the wheelhouse for the deck.
"If we can," thought Sam, "if we can."
He fancied they might have fouled on a wreck, and that meant the whole gear would be lost again. He came on deck, donned his oilskins and boots, his sou'wester and apron, and went out to join the others. The bridle had been cast off, and the warp led forward and taken round the capstan. Now the steam valve was opened, and the drum revolved slowly, bringing in the heavy rope. Daffodil, broadside onto the sea, rolled and lurched. Seas sluiced across her iron decks. A cloud of seagulls appeared from nowhere and circled round, screeching and tumbling, while the men not employed on stowing the warp stood at the leeward bulwarks, leaning over the side, anxiously watching it as it came slowly up out of the muddy sea. When the slack had all been hauled in and the weight of the beam and trawl came on the warp, the capstan grunted and slowed up, but the line still came in. Those watching over the side saw the big swivel at the fork of the bridle and the two ropes running out to the ends of the beam. Then the beam itself appeared out of a trough of the sea.
"That'll do,"
called the skipper. The capstan stopped and the warp was made fast. The crew peered down into the muddy water, but the net held its secret and they could not see what was in the poke, for this was still dangling some 20 feet below. They did not like it. The trawl was not foul of the bottom, as they had thought. It had come up without a murmur. There must be something in the net. And that something was more likely to be a mine than anything else. Some were for casting the gear adrift at once and taking no chances. But the skipper shook his head. He was not losing a second lot without making sure. He ordered tackles to be secured to the ends of the beam to draw it up. After about an hour's heavy labour, they had it lashed securely to the bulwarks. The next thing was to get in the net. It hung down from the beam, appearing and disappearing as Daffodil rolled. The men, spread out along the bulwarks, all leaned out together, seizing the meshes in their red, horny hands. As the ship rolled down, they hauled the net up over the rail, hung on as she rose, and, as she dipped again, hauled a second time, taking the slack of the net down under the gunwale and holding it there with their knees. Between every haul they peered downwards, while the seagulls swooped past, screeching for scraps. They had got in a few feet when young Percy suddenly yelled,
"I can see something!"
He pointed down under water, and all the men, holding fast to the net, leaned over to look where his arm stretched out.
"Something round it is!"
"It's a mine for sure,"
said Fred, and the thought of it there, just under the surface, kept them all transfixed, motionless. But the skipper was unperturbed.
"We'll just have a look. All the way there. Steady. Easy does it."
Again they reached out, seizing the meshes of the net and hauling as the Daffodil lurched over. When she rose again, there, in the meshes, a queer object broke water. It was a long black triangle with what looked like torn paper flapping from it. At one end was a sort of globe, choked with seaweed, silted with mud, and out of it two spikes stuck up with little funnels at the end.
"It's a mine! There, look at the horns!"
shouted Fred.
"That's no mine," said Jack. "Them's machine gun muzzles.
And the round thing's a turret, that's what it is."
"It's a bit of a ruddy aeroplane, that's what it is." "It's a bit of a Heinkel, all the way."
And together they pulled their catch higher out of the water.
"That's no Heinkel," said Percy. "Jerry don't have turrets like that. It's one of our own. Look, I can see the red, white and blue there, on the fin."
When at last they got it aboard, this the strangest catch that ever men took from the sea, they all clustered round it on the deck. There was part of the fin and twisted rudder, the turret, eaten away with the seawater and clogged with sand and a long piece of fabric that had torn off. It had been painted black, but now, covered with mud and seaweed and barnacles, it was dirty brown. When they cleaned it up, sluicing it with buckets of seawater, they could just make out something. It was the aircraft letter, the letter P, painted in red on the black side of what once had been the fuselage of a Wellington bomber. Percy scratched his head, spat reflectively over the side.
"Poor sods," he said. "Wonder if any of them got away with it."
A feeling of presentiment hung round Station HQ. The group captain had been to a conference at command some days before. He returned in good spirits, but he didn't give anyone the gen, not even his two wing commanders. And this set the whole station agog. The feeling communicated itself without words by a sort of telepathy and ran through the camp.
"There's a big show on. It's Berlin this time, or Hamburg, Cologne, Düsseldorf, Munich."
So went the thoughts and whispers. The station was on its toes. They were proud of their pilots and crews, proud that they had been chosen as a Pathfinder squadron. They were picked men. Everyone picked for the efficiency and skill of their work, picked to be the spearhead of the bomber offensive, and their morale was on the top line. Then the weather had gone dud for 3 days and the whole place grew restless. Only the ground crews welcomed the chance to get the kites perfect, to bring the serviceability up to 100%. No leave was granted.
Oh, there's a show on all right.
Nobody could leave camp. And the Met officer was the focus of everybody's interest and attention. All day long, he was closeted with his assistants, poring over his charts. Yards and yards of teleprinter stuff was always coming in, and when decoded, gave the pressures and temperatures and wind strengths and cloud formations from 100 places. From America, from Iceland, from Africa, from Russia, from 100 stations and observation posts, the figures came in. "Here," said the messages. The weather is... And by piecing all these signals together, a picture of the weather began to appear. A series of queer lines on the chart, bulging out here, running close together there, and moving, always moving, over the face of the earth. The forecasters ornamented them with little arrows and dots and hieroglyphs, the symbols of their own private magic. To the laymen, the finished article meant nothing, but to the forecaster, these contours called isobars meant a lot. Moreover, by comparing the latest picture with those that had come in before, the tendency of the whole weather system could be observed. If each map had been transferred to film, the sequence, when run off, would have brought the maps to life, and the depressions would have been seen surging back and forth like the shadows of waves on the floor of a sunlit sea. But the film always stopped dead in the present. It could not look into the future, and it was with the future that the aircraft crews were concerned. They wanted to know the weather over the target in 3 hours' time. They wanted the weather when they got back to base in 6 hours' time. And this is where the genius of the forecaster came in. This was why a good forecaster was as valuable to air operations as any member of the organization, for he had to guess and guess right. There was art in it, the art of the diagnostician, weather sense, and above all, clinical experience. If he made a mistake, the raid might be a failure. If he miscalculated the time that fog would set in by an hour or two, there might be dozens of aircraft lost, wandering about the country blind, staggering down on strange aerodromes, crashing, bailing out, loss of life, loss of hundreds of thousands of pounds worth of war equipment. Small wonder the forecaster was a cautious and harassed man. For the truth was that the weather was the commanding officer of all air operations in Northern Europe. Ministers and air marshals might trumpet announcements of what they were going to do to the enemy, but the weather had a knack of disregarding these outbursts and deciding, as it did in the winter of 40 to 41, to keep the whole bomber force grounded for weeks at a time. So when, on the fourth morning, the squadron was warned for ops that night, there was considerable relief.
"Must be a decent forecast at last," said the crews,
and dispersed to check up their aircraft. On the perimeter track, the lorry dropped the wing commander's crew near their aircraft. The men strolled over towards the machine. There were five of them, three officers and two sergeants, but the difference of rank would never have been noticed from their conversation. They didn't think of themselves as officers and other ranks. They thought of themselves as a unit, the crew of the aircraft. P for Pathfinder, the wing commander's crew, the veterans who had done 27 operational trips together. It was Nobby Bly, the rear gunner, a pert little cockney from the Edgware Road who had got the signwriter to put up on the side of the Wimpy, "I go, I come back," and under it to paint one little bomb for each raid. The number had grown steadily, 10, 15, 20, 25. Now they would soon have to start a third row. Nobby was the tail gunner, Arsend Charlie, and besides his pert cockney humour and good spirits, he could perform on the mouth organ like a professional. Sometimes, after the show was over and they were well on the way home, the wing commander would ask him for a tune, and he would open his mask and play into the mic, while the others listened on the intercom and sometimes joined in the chorus. It was strictly against regulations, so they kept quiet about it, but it helped to pass the time. Next to him walked Sam Dollar, the Canadian front gunner. While Nobby was spare and wiry, Sam was slow and heavy and thick-set. He said little, but was forever chewing mint gum, which gave him a powerful and pungent odour. But as Nobby said, "Better to stink like roast mutton than like a drain, which you would otherwise, Sam." While Sam's reply, admirably terse, is quite unprintable. These two were the firepower of the Wellington, and they knew their stuff. Nobby had already collected a DFM for getting a couple of JU-88s on one raid a month back, and Sam cursed his luck at having the front turret, since no Hun ever attacked head-on, and declared that they ought to change turrets every trip.
God damn it, Nobby, give me a break, can't you? I'll sit in that goddamn icebox till the end of the war, freezing my butt off, and never fire a shot.
I'll swap with you, Sam. Honest I would. But, you see, the crew needs an ace in the dustbin, and...
But usually at this point he had to get out of range of Sam's right, which swung out and carried quite a lot of weight. But if the men were not close friends, they got on together all right.
Nobby got on with everybody,
and Sam, who was slow on everything except the trigger, grew used to the little Cockney's humour, and secretly admired in him the qualities he lacked in himself. Next to Sam walked Peter Morelli, flying officer, the second pilot of the aircraft. He posed as a Canadian, but was really an American, and the way he came to England and enlisted would make a book in itself. He had a pleasant drawl, a winning smile, and some intangible and irresistible charm that drew both men and women to him.
"He's a wizard bloke," was the verdict of the mess.
He was only 23, but had packed a lot into the years, and those who had been on a binge in town with him told how he knew everybody, how he remembered people's faces and their names, how he would laughingly push the pianists out of their seats in jazz bands and beat them at their own game. If it was a question of a party or a dance or any entertainment, Peter was always called in. An officer with exceptional social gifts, the CO had written in his half-yearly confidential report, and it was no more than the truth. A little behind these three walked Cookson, the navigator, and Lukin, the wireless operator, his thin, stalky figure stooping slightly as he walked. Lukin was a man of few words, some thought a man with an inferiority complex.
"Perhaps it's because he's a Jew," said the mess after a complete failure to draw him.
But it wasn't that. He was a preoccupied man, inside whose head a lot of things were going on.
"It's like a canful of maggots," he confided once to his favourite brother before the war. The only person who could get him to open up was Peter, for Bingy Lukin had been a film critic on a London paper, and Peter knew all about shows.
But even then he didn't expand much.
"Gee, but isn't he a dry guy, though?" said Peter.
And the mess nodded and agreed. But after all, he was harmless enough and carried out his work methodically and well, so they let him alone. Both Lukin and Cookson were officers. Lukin had been commissioned on the completion of his training. He wore the thin blue stripe of the pilot officer, which would get fatter when he automatically became a flying officer 6 months later. But Cookson had worn the broad single stripe for almost a year, and the general opinion was that he would be singled out to go on one of the advanced navigational courses and get his second ring before it was due. He had become one of the finest navigators in Bomber Command by dint of a fanatical zeal for his job. He lived and dreamed navigation. Nothing else, except perhaps his little cutter, the Dolphin, now laid up in a yard far away in Fiji, was at all important to him. Or perhaps other things were, but he never spoke of them. And only his relations back in Auckland, getting his rare letters every 6 months or so, knew anything of his philosophy of life. He had quite unusual powers of concentration. In fact, this was the noticeable thing about him. He became absolutely absorbed in what he was doing. He was strongly made, fresh complexioned, and under his square forehead, two blue eyes looked out that were so clear, candid, and resolute that you did not forget that face once the eyes had been turned on you. You felt he knew exactly where he stood and exactly what he was going to do, why he was going to do it, and where he would stand when he had done it. This self-confidence, backed as it was by high professional skill, was extraordinarily reassuring.
The man seemed solid as a rock, absolutely dependable in all circumstances. The impression was heightened by his deliberate speech and his friendly smile. Yet, curiously, he was not a man you could get to know. He was strangely unapproachable. Men felt that he might be straight-laced or look with disapproval on some of the more bawdy spirits in the mess. But if he was, he never showed it. He just didn't join in. He wasn't interested. It was preoccupation. He lived for the job. The difference between competence and excellence in any profession is difficult to define. It is largely a matter of flair. Given the technical knowledge, given the ability of two men, the one who will stand out must have something akin to the artist who in some mysterious way is able to synthesize out of dull facts a new situation, an unexpected deduction, always clear enough when it is stated. But to a lesser man, fogged by other considerations, the pros and cons from which he is unable to extricate the matrix. Therefore, this must be so, or therefore I must do so and so, therefore the result is... Cookson, as has been said, was a fanatic for detail. He checked and double-checked all his data, his courses, his wind speeds, his drifts. He politely but firmly insisted on accurate flying from his pilot, insisted on being informed of any deviation from course, the least change of airspeed, the least variation of height.
"By Jove,"
said one pilot, after having been on a show with him, "I felt like a bloody pupil back at an EFTS. Never had to fly so accurately in my life. Fagged out I was when we got back. But we came out plumb over the target in filthy weather, too, got rid of the stuff and were off home before Jerry could do anything about it. He's a kingpin navigator, all right." But this careful plodding, this infinite capacity for taking pains, was not the whole story. Cookson added to it night vision of an unusually high order and a photographic eye for country. Show him a landfall, the lie of a town, the shape of a target once, and he never forgot it. If he returned to the same place at a different height, on a different course, in different weather, he always knew. Crossing and recrossing the enemy coast on raid after raid, he stored away in his head every detail of the country. Then, on a thick night, through a momentary gap in a cloud, he would spot a patch of country and know, without a shadow of doubt, exactly where he was. Many a pilot, flying over the same area day after day, absorbs the shape of it almost subconsciously, knows, almost without knowing why he knows, every road and field. All this is lumped together and called air sense. Cookson had developed it to a degree that his assurance was almost uncanny. "He doesn't navigate, he smells his way there. I believe he'd teach the pigeons how to navigate. Now then, Pidgey," he'd say, "fly at 800 feet on a course of 274.5 true and allow 16 degrees of starboard drift. Wouldn't be a bad idea if he could. The bloody birds might get home then." So said the mess in Cookson's hearing, and he just smiled and went on reading. Now, as they walked over to the aircraft, he was thinking of Lukin. The man was new to the crew. Cookson hadn't flown with him before. Getting wireless bearings and fixes is the wireless operator's job. Cookson used them, chiefly as checks on his own work, and he liked to have them accurate. Therefore, for the success of the show, he wanted Lukin to feel at ease, wanted to gauge his ability to form some sort of contact with him. "Ever flown with the wing commander before?" he inquired.
"Not on a show."
"He's first class. Wonderful on instruments. Steady as a rock. Makes my job far easier."
"Anything particular you want from me?" Lukin inquired.
"No, I don't think so. I'll try to get a drift as we leave the coast, but if you can give me a bearing or two when we get up, it may help." "I suppose he's all right," he was thinking. "Supposed to be quite sound, but I wish we hit Ginger all the same."
He was used to the man.
had done upwards of 20 trips with him. He liked working with men he knew. Lukin seemed to read his thoughts. I expect you'll miss Ginger, but I'll... He was going to say, do my best, but altered it, and the words came out, try to fit in.
Of course you will.
Cookson's tone was absolutely genuine. He meant it.
Glad you're coming along. It's a swell crew to be with.
P for Pathfinder stood in the edge of a wood. Trees had been cleared to pass her in, and camouflage nets lay over her wings. You might have passed the aerodrome and never seen her, snugged down into the greenery. Her nose just protruded, and her low, cumbersome body lay close to the ground. She seemed heavy, ungainly, and her matte black paint detracted further from any grace she might have had. But she looked solid and reliable, very much made for the job, and the fact that Wellingtons had been in service ever since the outbreak of war proved beyond any doubt the value of the type. The men who flew in them swore by them. They would stand up to any amount of punishment.
By God, I believe if a Wimpy was shot in half, both halves would get home.
This was the pilot's verdict, and when you saw photos of the state in which some of them had got home, it was quite possible to believe it. Sam and Nobby were already by the machine. Below the nose, a thin ladder reached down to the ground. Sam's legs were disappearing up this. He drew himself in and clambered, doubled up, past the bomb aimer's place, up into the front turret, where the two Browning guns pointed forward and up into the sky. Nobby had walked under the wing to the entrance halfway down the belly. He clambered in and felt his way down to the tail. Then he pulled back the two spring-loaded doors and wormed himself through into the tail turret. Through these little doors, he would have to leave the aircraft if ordered to bail out. He would spin the turret broadside on and then just fall over backwards through the doors. It was the best exit of the lot, provided the turret didn't jam. No chance of hitting the tail, as there was when you had to bail out from the escape hatches forward. Now he settled into his seat and began his inspection of the guns. He examined the breech blocks, the feeds, the ejector chutes. He tested the mechanisms with dummy rounds, checked the reflector sight, saw that he had spare bulbs, and then started giving the perspex a clean-over. He felt snug and at home in there, though there was hardly room to move. His two guns were mounted one each side of his knees. His controls to swing the turret, to raise and lower the elevation of the guns, lay on a sort of handlebar before him. These operated on hydraulic power derived from the starboard engine. He would test this as they taxied round to take off. Now he carefully reloaded the guns and placed the firing button on safe. Then he sat back. He was quite alone down in the tail turret when they were airborne, and although he could speak to the others over the intercom, he felt separate and was glad of his loneliness, looking back out over the empty sky. There he could relax. Not from the job, for he never thought of letting up on that, but from the smoke screen of good spirits that he put up all day and every day to cover his grief. For Nobby's wife was dying quite slowly and inexorably, and nothing could be done about it. But there, alone in the turret, he could think about her, send out his thoughts to cheer and strengthen her. Sometimes, under the majesty of the starlit sky, with the world so far below, he felt curiously remote and powerful, like a god. He knew then that his thoughts did do her good. His will would triumph over the hand of death. She would recover. He would make her. Sometimes, again, he felt so very small, such an atom in the terrible void of night, that he despaired. Then he would pray. It came easy to do it up there in the dark, though he never could do it below. Oh God, spare my Sally and leave her with me for a bit longer, because I love her so. That was all he could manage, not being a religious man in the usual way. But he was proud that none of his mates, nor relations, nor friends knew, only he and his mother. He could trust her, nobody else. And Sally, of course, last of all. She would never know. There was some comfort in that. Not much, but anyway, it was better for him to carry it for both of them. It was about all he could do for her. His reverie was interrupted by a voice coming through on the earphones in the helmet that hung nearby.
Hello, Tail Gunner. This is wireless operator. Can you hear me?
Nobby switched on the mic and answered.
Yes, getting you okay. Guns tested and found correct. Are you receiving me?
Receiving you loud and clear, came the answer.
Nobby hung up the mask and helmet again and clambered out of the turret up the fuselage to join the rest of the crew forward of the bomb bay. The aircraft would be bombed up later in the day and everything checked by the armament officer. The load was almost entirely incendiaries, slim cases of magnesium and phosphorus that would burn and burn and burst and burn again. For wholesale arson, they were about as effective a weapon as anyone had yet devised, and P for Pathfinder carried dozens of them, neatly tucked away in their racks and canisters like so many vipers' eggs. These small, inert objects, hidden inside the black fuselage of a bomber in a corner of the English countryside, were destined that night to be carried several hundred miles and to be dropped whistling down on the roofs of houses and warehouses to start vast raging conflagrations in which whole areas of a city would be laid waste and hundreds of human beings would be burned, crushed, suffocated or mutilated for life. It didn't bear examination, of course, and none of the crew ever dreamed of examining it. They were entirely devoid of conscience, all of them. Their only thoughts on the matter were technical, how to get there, how to get a direct hit on the target, and how to get back. It was as if a man conceiving a murder had become so entirely absorbed in the technique of carrying it out, in its ingenuity and success, that he entirely lost sight of the fact that it was murder. The crime became quite incidental, unimportant. The interest and satisfaction lay in the technique. No man could have carried on with a bomber's job if he looked at it otherwise. As Nobby passed the bomb bay, he heard voices from forward. Lukin's voice testing his transmitter.
Hello, Columbine. Hello, Columbine. This is P for Pathfinder calling. This is P for Pathfinder calling. Are you receiving me? Are you receiving me? Over.
Switches clicked, and the voice of Bass was heard coming back so loud that Nobby could hear it standing by Lukin's headphones.
Hello, P for Pathfinder. Hello, P for Pathfinder. Receiving you loud and clear. Receiving you loud and clear. Over.
The switches clicked again, and Lukin continued his tests. Closed down, switched on his loop receiver, tested that, tested his Morse key, saw to his spare coils and batteries and bulbs. He went through it all slowly, methodically, while the wireless mechanic stood watching him. At this moment, the starboard engine started up with a roar, and a minute later the port engine joined in. Morelli was at the controls and sat there doing a general check while the motors warmed up. Meanwhile, Cookson was lying flat on his stomach in the bomb aimer's position, testing the selector gear, looking over the sight and testing the bomb doors. Morelli checked the hydraulics, fuel gauges, flaps, and all the rest of the pilot's controls. He ran up the engines one after the other, looked out of the port side window to the flight mechanic on the ground below, and gave him the okay, then called up the rest of the crew on the intercom. A few seconds later, P for Pathfinder crept slowly out onto the perimeter track and turned towards the runway to carry out her NFT. All crews were summoned to the ops room for briefing at 6 o'clock, 1800 hours. They crowded into the bare room with the maps and charts on the walls and waited for Wingco Ops and the station navigator. When they arrived, with the group captain himself, the whole room stood to its feet. He acknowledged with a salute.
"Carry on, smoke if you like,"
he said, took off his hat and laid it on the table.
Then he turned to the crews as they sat down and lit up.
There's a big show on for tonight, and I have a message from the AOC&C to read to you.
He took the paper from a folder and paused before reading it.
The more heavily we can bomb the enemy, the sooner the war will be over. His heavy industry, his shipyards, his centres of communications must be smashed. The people who work at those industries must be bombed out, evacuated, and their work disrupted. We have now a big enough bomber force to do this, and we are going to do it. Town by town, city by city, German industrial life is going to be annihilated. I therefore call on all of you for a maximum effort tonight and in our future raids. Leave nothing undone. Let nothing stand in your way. Get there. Send your load down on the target. Every bomb is a nail in Germany's coffin. Make sure you drive it right home. Good luck to you.
He put the paper away and a murmur ran round the room. The faces became more expectant.
The target tonight is Kiel, he went on. Some of you have been there before and given it a pasting, but tonight we intend to flatten it out. Now, there's a difference between this raid and others we have made before. We're going to use a new technique, which we think will not only be more effective against the enemy, but will also reduce our losses. So, and he smiled, I expect you'll all want to know what it is. Well, it's quite simple. We're going to send everyone in at once. There will be several hundred aircraft on the target, and the whole raid will be over within half an hour. You can see what this will mean. The ground defences will be swamped. The firefighting services will be swamped. The whole organisation that the enemy has built to deal with raids will be inadequate. With so many aircraft over the target at one time, he'll be paralysed. The anti-aircraft won't know what to shoot at. His radio location will go haywire. And altogether, it ought to be a piece of cake. He paused. For the main body of the force, that is. Our job is the same as ever, to light up that target, to make it a beacon that the other boys can see 30 miles away. But what applies to all the others in the CNC's message applies particularly to us. We've got to get there to make sure of getting there and nowhere else. The whole success of the raid depends on us. It also depends, of course, on the most accurate timing. Nobody must be late. The times of departure must be those arranged to the second. The courses must be accurately steered and adhered to. They've given us 5 minutes grace to check up, make the final approach as we like, find the best height, and so on. All that's up to you, but you must be off target at the time specified. Don't hang about. Kiel's going to be like Piccadilly at the rush hour, so when you've done your job, get out as quickly as you can.
He paused again and looked round.
I know you'll all put up a good show. That's all I have to say. Will you carry on, Hobbs?
Then the routine of the briefing was carried out. The best height, having regard to the forecast, the time of the run-out, given the met wind, the best approach to avoid concentrations of flak and night fighter areas, prominent landfalls and landmarks, the bomb load to be carried, so it went on. To a stranger, much of it would have seemed jargon, almost a shorthand speech, for it assumed a background of common knowledge so thoroughly understood that it never needed to be referred to. At last, the meeting broke up, the men dispersed. There was a meal to be got in, and, for some, a brief rest to be fresher for the job. But for the navigators, there would be no rest. They still had a lot to do. They went into a huddle round the table, discussing the gen, consulting the forecast, working carefully on courses and drifts and times. It was fascinating and important work, for a duff navigator who miscalculates can ruin a show. Most of the calculations were preliminary, subject to alteration in the air, but the basis of a good show is laid in the ops room. These men were leaving nothing to chance.
Let's see, said the group captain. You're taking Lukin in place of Ginger, are you, Hugh?
Hugh Thornley, who had been following all Cookson's calculations, straightened up when the group captain spoke. Below his wings, a DSO and a DFC, besides two other service medals, decorated his battle dress, making a dirty coloured line on that well-worn garment. The three full rings of Wing Commander rank were stitched on his shoulder straps. He was the Pathfinder Squadron Commander and the leader of the night's operation.
"Yes, sir," he said. "Nichols a bit fed up at having to put in a stooge, but I think it's best if I borrow Lukin in view of the importance of the show."
The group captain nodded.
"Got a moment?" he asked.
"Of course, sir," Hugh rejoined.
"Nothing more you want of me, is there, Cookson?"
Cookson shook his head.
"No, thanks, sir. I think I've got it all buttoned up."
The CO closed the door of his office and strolled over to his desk.
"I was talking to Group today on the phone. It seems they may want you to take over a station pretty soon."
"Where?" Hugh's face didn't seem particularly pleased.
"One of the new ones down south. It's not settled yet. I said I couldn't spare you. But of course, it is time you got your other ring."
"I don't want to go much. And I shouldn't like to be off flying.
I sometimes wonder how you stick it, Steve. All the bumf, all the kicks, all the stooging around between here and Group and Command. And none of the fun."
Stephen Burley smiled up at the younger man. He had always liked Hugh Thornley. And now, after seeing him on the job for 3 months or more, he admired him. But as he looked at the quick, intelligent head and the sure expression of the eyes, Burley detected a slight tendency to nervousness, a touch of strain.
It was the merest trace, nothing the casual observer would notice, but Burley had done a lot of ops himself. He knew how it took you, and he was used to detecting it in his men. He could tell, sometimes before they could, when it was getting too much for them. He was a good CO, and he positively pampered his crews, if the men were good. If anyone tried to swing the lead or wavered, he was as hard as nails. But the good ones, and that went for most, when they were getting near the end of their tour of ops, you could always tell. They didn't say anything. They wouldn't admit it, even to themselves, most of them. But he knew, and he could see it now in Hugh. The way he moved about, sat first on the edge of the desk and then on the edge of the chair, the way he shook the coppers in his pocket. Yes, it was time he had a rest. He had had a long talk up at Group with the Air Vice Marshal and succeeded in getting Hugh the station. He deserved it, if ever a man did. And his eyes looked decidedly tired. The face was somehow drawn, older. Yes, it was time he had a rest. "Oh, I don't know, you get used to it. It's interesting, looking at the thing more broadly, getting an idea of the general plan. Some of these conferences are damned instructive."
He got up.
"Well, I expect you want to get along. How's Nobby?"
"Wonderful. He makes the trip for me. Some of his comments over the target ought to be collected. They're wizard." Hugh strolled over to the door and paused with his hand on the knob.
"Dollar's a curious bloke, you know. Real backwoodsman. There's something secretive about him. I never have been able to size him up. The others I know pretty well. You do after a bit. But Dollar, he's queer." "But tough. Tough as they make him. You've got a swell crew, Hugh. The best ever. Always seems a pity the way crews break up at the end of a tour.
We've got it all fixed up to keep in touch after the war." Burley smiled and nodded.
"Yes, I know. One does. Oh, by the way, Hugh, any news from the home front?"
"Any minute now." He turned laughing and blushing slightly.
"I rang last night. How's Helen?"
"Well, it can't be much fun for a woman, really, but she sounded frightfully cheery."
"You know, Hugh,"
Steve Burley leaned against the wall, looking at him,
"I admire you for the way you've managed the wife business. There's no getting round it. They're a damned nuisance when chaps are on ops. It's only natural, of course, but they do undermine men. And what can you expect? They ought all to be sent to concentration camps that can't be reached except on long leave.
I believe the men would be happier too. I don't like them hanging around or being within range even.
Hugh nodded.
Yes, I quite agree. Helen and I talked it out long ago. We decided she oughtn't to be around while the party was on. I couldn't stand it, and she couldn't either. I'm glad she's had the kid to think about. That's helped a lot. And Squirrels isn't quite a concentration camp either.
How old's Pam now?
Rising 3, and much too old there. That young woman will be a menace when she grows up.
What's the betting this time?
It's 10-1 on a son. Will you take me?
Steve shook his head.
No, but I'll stand godfather if you like. That'll cost me a packet.
It's a deal. Hugh turned to go again. I must be off, sir. See you at supper?
Yes, I'll be around. It ought to be quite a show tonight.
Hugh nodded.
If only the weather doesn't clamp. Well, so long, sir.
He went out and closed the door. A tender dropped the flying control officer at his post on the leeward end of the runway. He tried out his signalling lamps and the chance light, tested his field telephone, saw that the blood wagon and fire tender were present with their crews, and then strolled over to his position near the runway and lit a cigarette. Night had fallen. The big wind had blown up some cloud, but there were clear patches through which he could see the stars. The vast, flat expanse of the aerodrome seemed to stretch to the very confines of the night. 2 rows of lights, tiny, bright, hooded pinpoints, marked the edges of the runway, a long, smooth concrete track, wider than an arterial road. This was the gateway through which the bombers had to pass up into the night. This was the gateway through which some of them would return. Not all, he supposed. Not all. Must expect some losses. And he began to wonder who, but checked himself with a guilty feeling. He was superstitious, like many who live close to danger. Perhaps a man's thought might somehow influence the course of destiny. It was probably rot, but there, alone on the runway, near to the men who were to go, messmates with them, a man gets curious twinges of foreboding, curious throwbacks into his own prehistoric past. He lives, through them, on the edge of a precipice, never knowing the hour. So we fly up and down the valley of the shadow of death till one by one we fall into it. So a close friend, a scholar, one of the bravest and cheerfulest, had written some time before he never came back. Most of them didn't see themselves from the outside like that, couldn't or wouldn't face it, believed that whatever happened to the others, they would come through. A good thing, he reflected, a good thing. Better so. He stamped up and down to keep warm, flicked his torch onto his wristwatch. 10 minutes to go, then stamped up and down again. It was a bad time, the time just before the takeoff. Everybody hated it. The crews said it was the worst of the lot. The tension affected him and keyed him up. He who had nothing to do but flash a green at them. He who ran no risk and would sleep sound that night in a warm bed. He felt one of their company and, perhaps, just because of his impotence, every bit as strung up as they. Out of the darkness, from all points of the compass, he could hear engines running. At each dispersal point, crews were assembling, piling in their parachutes, handing up their pigeons, their sandwich boxes and thermos flasks, squeezing up the narrow companionways, taking their places. Little flickers of blue flame sputtered out of exhaust manifolds. Torches flashed here and there. From within the cockpits came the dull glow of instrument lights. There was activity everywhere. Silent activity of men who were used to a job and didn't need to speak about it. It wasn't a time when anyone had much to say, and anyway it would have been drowned by the motors. To the silent listener out there on the flare path, the roar of the distant engines rose and fell as they were run up, a curious, deep, angry roar of power,
Thousands and thousands of horsepower, unleashed at a touch, controlled by a finger, flying out in a whirl of fury, dying back to a sullen whisper. There was something compelling and inspiring about it. It throbbed through the very core of you. The fitter was leaning over Hugh Thornley's shoulder as he ran up his engines. He ran them up carefully, first the starboard, then the port, testing the magnetos, the mixture controls, checking the oil pressures and the boost, the variable pitch airscrew control, and going through the whole of that complicated routine, the ritual of the cockpit check. He did it methodically and unperturbably, while the fitter, watching over his shoulder, followed his eyes from dial to dial. Satisfied, he put his thumb up, and the fitter handed him Form 700. That form, without signing which, no RAF pilot goes into the air. The form which certifies that the pilot is satisfied with the state of the aircraft. Thornley signed, handed back the greasy stub of pencil with the form.
"Good luck, sir!"
the fitter shouted in his ear. Hugh smiled and turned to Peter Morelli, who was settling into his seat beside him.
"All set?"
Peter nodded. Thornley slipped his mask in front of his face, flipped over the microphone switch with his finger, and called up the rest of the crew. One by one, they answered with a brief, "All set," or "OK." Then he released his brakes, opened his throttles slightly, and began to taxi out onto the perimeter track. The big bomber crept forward slowly. Thornley followed the directions of an airman who was walking backwards ahead of the machine, signalling him how to steer by means of two torches. Once out, onto the perimeter track, he swung the aircraft right and still very slowly crept round the airfield to the leeward end of the takeoff runway.
"Front gunner to captain," came the voice on the intercom. "Permission to test my gun, sir?"
"Okay."
A burst of fire from the two front guns blazed out past the starboard wingtip into the gun pit beside the perimeter track. For a split second, the spinning disc of the airscrew and the underside of the wing were lit by the tracer flashes. Then darkness again. The bomber crept on.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.